super excited to have Alan Blaustein here, who is a multiple, very successful entrepreneur who's done a lot of things which he can probably tell us a little bit more about in more detail. But he's got a very cool, very interesting new startup, CarePlanners, which he's not here to pitch. He's more here to talk about his experiences as a startup. He's been first a lawyer, actually helping some of these technologies and some of the technology-based companies go all the way through their process, and then has had some very interesting experiences, both from the tech side as a sort of practitioner, but also from as an attorney, and is now, I think, really well positioned in this new space. Particularly interesting as I think, I'm pretty sure that Alan will talk about his personal experience as well, which has been quite unique, from really experiencing the hard way about some of the challenges in the system that he was facing when he had cancer, and then to sort of go through that whole process and decide, you know what, I'm actually going to fix this system that is broken. So super excited to have Alan here to give us some experiences that he's had, and we're calling it Top 10 Lessons I've Learned. Welcome, Alan.
Thank you, Steve. No worries. Good evening, everybody. I'm glad to be here tonight. My name is Alan Blaustein, and I'm the founder of a company named CarePlanners. By quick background, thank you. And before I get there, I do want to say thank you to Steven and to Katie and this whole organization, because things like Aging 2.0 are what create the sustainable marketplaces that we need to move forward. So I just encourage and applaud everybody in here who's an entrepreneur and who's trying to build a business or trying to figure out a different way about it. And I implore you to keep going, because without a sustainable economy of startups, the city doesn't do as well in the next century. So Steve and Katie, thank you, and whatever we can do to support your efforts. By way of quick background, and we'll start working through this, I was an attorney in the late 1990s during the Internet 1.0 boom, and took roughly 20 of those companies public and helped another 50 through their financings. So I've seen a lot of startups work their way through the system. I've seen a lot of them succeed. I've seen a lot of them fail. And when it was time for me to move on from that, I went into the early team of a company named About.com, which is in the media and entertainment space. And we were luckily and brilliantly able to take that public and then sell that 2 years later. Following that, I've started another number of businesses. Some of them have worked, some have not. I'm co-founder of an e-commerce company named OpenSky, which is celebrity curated shopping. So if Shaq likes this clicker, Shaq will tell you to buy the clicker, and hopefully you'll buy the clicker, and we'll make a little bit of money off that. But as Steven suggested, my passion lies with a company named CarePlanners. In 2005, I was diagnosed with stage 4 thymic cancer. Thymus is a gland between the heart and the lung, which in utero helps you with immune system development, and for most of us shrinks down to the size of a pig. Unfortunately, in 500 of us, it grows larger and explodes in the chest cavity. So I have absolutely sat on the other side of the scalpel, on the other side of the stethoscope, on the other side of the catheter, on the other side of a lot of other things that I won't walk through with this group. But the inefficiencies in the healthcare system are absolutely beyond belief. We all know them or we wouldn't be in the room right now. And so as I was getting better and I was struggling with navigating the healthcare system for myself, I had 8 doctors, I had 4 different medical institutions, I'm on 12 medications, I'm dealing with the insurance company, that's before I got my diagnosis. And then I get my diagnosis, I call my insurance company, and they can't find it on the drop-down menu. So they're trying to convince me I have tonsil cancer, I have tongue cancer, I have everything but thymic cancer. And you're sitting there on the other end, and you're sort of heavily sedated, and you're wondering, what's going on here? And the person that helped me through the process is a very dear friend of mine, Dr. Nancy Snyderman, who you might know from the Today Show and the NBC Nightly News. And the fascinating thing was, she was going through the process of navigating the system for her elderly parents who weren't living close to her. And amazingly, a lot of the inefficient issues were the same. Now, Nancy's parents weren't diagnosed with dementia, but you know, when you're diagnosed with a particular disease, you have 15 or 20 different decisions to make. You can do it, or you can get some help. You know, we have other complex systems that have developed in this country. Your legal system is complex, your tax system is complex, and professions have grown up around those. You have your attorney, you have your accountant, and now with us, you have your care planner. So briefly, we took 100 or 200 different independent patient advocates around the country, nurses, social workers, insurance and billing folks. We've networked them together, and we've put them in a position that they can help you as a caregiver or you as a patient better navigate this system. They provide comprehensive services for senior care. They provide comprehensive services all the way through the pantheon of healthcare. Two quick examples. Mom's in Philadelphia, daughter number one's in Chicago, daughter number two's in Washington. Mom's going in for hip surgery. Having a third party objective project manager on the phone changes the entire dynamic, and I guarantee we'll keep mom in her house longer. Number two, we get the phone call the other day. Mom's about to be discharged from the hospital. The hospital just faxed me a list of 21 facilities they could send mom to. They want an answer in 45 minutes. How in the world are you supposed to do that without help? And so by calling us, we're able to help them get that 21 down to 3, which is manageable, and you can have some confidence in it. But I'm not really here to talk about care planners. I'm here about to talk about all the ones that I screwed up and all the other things that I've seen. And this is more for the early stage entrepreneurs than anybody in the room, so everybody else can just get a drink and hang out a little bit. But there really are 10 key lessons that I've learned, and they bounce around a little bit. I spend a lot of time mentoring younger startup companies. And you know, a gentleman comes to me the other day and goes, I have the greatest app you're ever going to see. Like, this thing is awesome. It's going to tell my doctor when I'm jogging down the road, when I'm out there at 6 in the morning, and he's going to be able to email me back. Look, you need to solve a problem. You need to know that the problem is out there. Somebody has to care, or else it's a tree falling in the forest when nobody is there. Okay? And associated with that, and along the same lines, is are you building a product or a business? And those are two very different animals. And those have two very different paths. Two very different paths to purchase, two very different paths to building into a marketplace. A product is fine. But if you're going to start talking to investors and other things and other people, make sure that you have a business. I have seen far too often people come into my office with, again, the coolest widget, the coolest app, which has a market of 100 people. That's great as part of something bigger. I was with somebody earlier today who has a product that does healthcare expense transparency. And they have a real nice widget for it. But you go, God, how are you going to do this without being integrated into the financial systems within the health plan? And how are you going to do this as an independent entity? And truth is, they're not. And so that is a beautiful product that is going to need to be part of something bigger. And I think entrepreneurs can get far down the line, and I think you have to question it regardless of the organization that you're in. Are you building businesses or are you building products? Related to that, oops, I didn't go up. So that was the first one. Sorry, somebody should have yelled at me. So, and these are in a random order, so we're not going to keep talking about exit strategies and the whole thing. It just happens to be what's number two. Who's going to buy you? This goes from an entrepreneurial standpoint. When you're building a business, build it backwards from your exit. Understand your marketplace. So I started a business that had one buyer, Google. And every day I prayed that Google would knock on my door and buy it. And Google never actually knocked on my door. And so I got to the end of the journey and had one buyer. As opposed to a marketplace, you know, I'm hopeful that CarePlanners, I find us complementary to everybody in the system, will have a lot of different channels interested. If you're working in an organization that's a startup and you can't figure out your path to an exit or cash flow positive or some of these other pieces of it, there can be some very nice cash flow positive businesses, but they're not the type of businesses that'll be bought. So now I'm flipping a little bit. And this is for everybody in the room. The culture of your organization matters. It matters incredibly so. You know, the folks here said that they love seniors. They love their folks that are here. That's a cultural statement. If you do not have a cultural statement of the why your business is in business, you will fail. If you're not crystal clear why you wake up every morning, you will fail. If everybody on the team does not share that same cultural belief, you as a team will fail. And you can differ on opinion, you can differ on perspective, you can differ on anything else, and this is in small organizations, and I've seen it in large organizations. But once you lose touch of your culture, you have already failed. So as you build your business, you need to be culture-based and value-based, and that impacts your hiring, that impacts your firing, that impacts your compensation, that frankly impacts your product. And so culture is so important at CarePlanners because, again, I want from a brand perspective people to know that they can trust us to help them navigate the healthcare system. Trust and integrity are the key parts of our culture. So everybody in the office signs our Jerry Maguire manifesto. And if everybody doesn't remember that movie with Tom Cruise, he basically thought there was a better way to do business. And so do we. And it's a 4-page document. And you want to know what? The ones that think that it's goofy, don't come work with us. And that's all fine by me. Leverage dictates reality. I think a lot of startups really lose sight of this, particularly as they're getting up and going. So if I am negotiating right now with GE, I am going to get my butt kicked. Not a lot I can do about it. But what you need to understand is the longer term view of what you're trying to accomplish.
As I'm speaking to...
Is it there? It's the left. As I'm speaking to investors, as I'm speaking to other partners, I've seen this in about, I've seen it at small companies. When the small company walks in the room and thinks their bridges are a little bit too big, they're not getting the deal done. Now, there's a time to be aggressive in terms of getting a deal done, but you also really have to understand what you're dealing with long term. So with CarePlanners, I'll probably do a few deals with some larger organizations where I will not get what I want, but they will be stepping stones to then get what I want. And 3 years from now, then you have the leverage. But I think
a lot of entrepreneurs forget this.
And I've seen it when I was practicing, and I've seen it when I've negotiated for people that I'm representing, when they want to take every single point off the table and winning every point. It's totally myopic. Just understand you can get what you can get out of your relationships with the bigger companies, but you have to be very careful about what you're asking for. So greed kills companies, which is interesting. So there was a company I was running a few years back. Great product. It was this disposable DVD product. And my two founders were business school academics. And we were a company that was nowhere in 2003. And we were riding a really good set of investors. And we were in a really good position to move forward. And we went out for the investment round, and the founders of the company wanted a set of valuation that was so inordinately high that we couldn't find the right investors. We found investors. We found people to put money in the company, but they weren't the right people. And understanding the whole thing, again, it's being myopic. And avoiding being myopic, I have found over and over that greed can kill companies. And by that I mean during your financing round. It's only a number. The only number you care about at the end of the day is what percent you own when you sell the company. All the stuff in the middle is all noise. And so for these founders, they ended up getting that next round of financing, but we couldn't close the deal. So they have a lot of paper. They'd say a lot of great numbers from a stock standpoint, and their bank account says zero. So you gotta be comfortable about that. And I say this to everybody, both in an entrepreneurial role, or if you're working with somebody in an entrepreneurial role, that you have to keep your mindset of, again, what is the organization trying to accomplish? The greed kills companies plays back into culture. What are the people there for? And this is not just entrepreneurial, this is the big companies, this is everything else. This all feeds into the same thing. So do your diligence. Had I known that these business school professors were so poorly focused and didn't understand business, which right now is anti-MBA because of this, would have never taken the job and worked at it for 4 years. My bad. I missed what they were going to do with the venture capitalists, and I missed what they were doing with our corporate partners, where I would be working hard with somebody who had a $5 billion budget, and they would go to the CEO of the company and try to have the CEO of the company jam down a deal that we were trying to do on the operating leader. Long story short, do your diligence. If something does not feel right, get out. If something doesn't feel right, don't get in. Comes back to culture again, comes back to all the other points. They're all tied together. In a bigger organization, again, you know, what kind of culture do you have? Make sure you're doing your diligence all the way. And frankly, this also applies to the entrepreneurs on the investors that are coming into your company. I have had excellent investors who are helpful, and I've had other ones that have just tried to take over the companies. Just because somebody has a check in front of you doesn't necessarily mean you take the check. It may cost you more than not. So this is one I really like, and this really applies to everybody. Rethink what you're doing from a business development standpoint. Too many people walk into a room like this, too many people walk into a situation, and they think business development is, what can I get from this conversation? I swear to you, if you flip it, and you start every conversation by figuring out what the other person needs, and you provide that to them, it will come back to you tenfold. And this is not a pithy sort of Bible story. I have seen it over and over and over again. Do unto others, and then they will do unto you. Which is absolutely backwards of all of us when we're under pressure to get business development accomplished. It is not intuitive to do it like this, but in every relationship, make sure that you are doing good first, pay it forward, and it will work. And it's important enough to bring up here because I've just seen it time and again at conferences or with clients or in meetings. You know, you sit with somebody in a meeting, they're not even listening to what you want to say. All they're doing is talking. And so I can assure you, you might get that deal, but you're not going to make something big happen. So I think this is the most important of all of it. And it goes back to culture and everything else. Make sure you have the right team. I can't stress it enough. I like to hire fast and fire fast, and I have the ability to do that because I'm running my own organization, and you may not because you're in a bigger organization, but the wrong team, the wrong energy, the wrong belief system could absolutely derail what you're trying to do as an organization. We've all seen it. We've all had the experience of that coworker whose butt should have been thrown out the door weeks ago, and for some reason he or she is still sitting there. And then 3 weeks later, you're spending 20 minutes with your coworkers complaining about that person. 2 weeks later, you're spending an hour complaining about that person. Another month later, you're totally distracted by it. None of us needs the noise of negative. And so as you're working through again, whether you're an entrepreneur or what, don't put up with it. Don't put up with it. They will not share your cultural values. And as painful as it is, you just get them out of your office. So the mistake I've made before is letting people stay for a month or two too long. And every single time I fired that person, the rest of the office has come to me and said, why didn't you do that 3 months ago? So if you're thinking somebody is not working out, believe me, you're not the only one. And then clearly, I hope everybody in this room is doing something that they're passionate about. Because if you're not passionate about what you're doing, you have no chance to succeed. Like, there's no greater passion for me, other than my three children, than figuring out how to make it easier for all of us to navigate the healthcare system. I saw what I went through. I have stories upon stories upon stories. I've seen what my friends have gone through. I see everybody in this room, and I can imagine that you all know one or two people that are struggling with this right now. Not sure where to turn. Can you turn to your employer about your mom? Probably not. Mom's not on the plan. Right? Can you talk to your insurance agent about your situation? You probably don't trust the insurance agent. I mean, so there's really no place where care coordination is sort of comprehensive. And that's my passion, to make it easier for all of us to figure out. And then finally, just in closing, I think this is probably just as important. Nobody knows shit. And the sooner that you realize it, the better you'll be. It's one of the most liberating things you'll ever appreciate. I don't know squat about what I just talked to you about for 10 or 12 minutes. I have no clue. For me, when I left law and went into my first business about.com, we're all sitting around the room, the internet's just starting. There are 8 of us, we've raised like $40 million. We're trying to figure out what's next, and I'm sitting in a meeting and everybody's looking around and going, okay, what are we gonna do? And absolute quiet. You realize very quickly that the ones that are sure, cocksure of what they're doing, are the least sure about what they're doing. And once you realize that nobody knows anything, then you get to dream, and you get to make it up. And for me, that's part of the passion and part of helping businesses. So in closing, anybody here that's an entrepreneur, my door is open however I can help you. For everybody else, I hope you enjoy the rest of the evening. And please follow your passion and build big businesses. And Stephen and Katie, thank you.
Thank you.
If I could just ask you to hold on to that microphone just for a couple of minutes. Not quite yet. Fantastic, really great presentation.
Thank you.
Really appreciate your passion and your support.
I think it applies everywhere. I mean, I'm as mission-driven as anybody else in this room. And, you know, moving aging one to aging two, I don't care what the discipline is. The question is, and it's not meant to be callous, are you running a for-profit organization? And are you trying to build a for-profit organization? Not-for-profit organizations are fabulous. I mean, I've started a few of them, I'm involved in a few of them, but when you're dealing with a for-profit organization...
You've been doing a lot already in the New York health innovation space in particular.
This is not mutually exclusive with doing good. I mean, you could do good, do well, do everything else that you need to do, but I think if you're going to build a big company and not a product, you always have to have an eye on the marketplace. Because, you know, whether or not it's health point one, health point two, aging one, aging two, you're still going to be stuck with the same set of questions. And frankly, you know, had I not put who's going to buy you, and I debated this for a little while, you got to get the cash flow positive. Right? So if it's not even about buying you and cash flow positive, that's not mutually exclusive with doing well. The way that we're pricing care planners is neither the lowest or the highest in the marketplace. And believe me, we're going to give a lot, and we're going to be a lower margin business because we want to do right. But at the end of the day, it is a for-profit venture.
Thank you. No, I think that's, I really wanted to stress that point and make sure everybody shares that perspective, because what we're interested in Aging 2.0 is really scaling businesses, and in our experience, the most effective way to really bring about change in creating ecosystem is with for-profit in partnership. Question, David.
So, can you tell us about valuation? You talked a little bit about it before, in terms of going into a pitch session, valuation is all about raising money. So, what three things, build on you, would you advise an entrepreneur to think about from a valuation perspective?
Sure, I think there are a lot of them. Whether or not I can come up with three off the top of my head.
Just wondering with Steve.
You know what, I think always number one, the value of the investor to you is a big part of determining the right valuation. So in one of my businesses, the disposable DVD business, we stuck to an extremely high valuation for no really good reason. Just because we decided that we wanted to hold certain equity after the particular investment. And so, you know, it's an inverse relationship with the quality of the investor there. Right? Right now, CarePlanners, I'm talking to some really quality folks. It's probably going to cost me a good bit on my valuation. But if you look at it from the end game in terms of doing it, you want people along the way who are going to provide you strategic guidance so that my 10% of where I end up is a heck of a lot more than what my 50% would have been otherwise. I think the two other things that you have to take a look at are, and one is not particularly selfish, I believe strongly in giving a lot of equity away to the team. And I think that's the only way to do it. These people are working harder than I am. And if you ask anybody on our team, I think it's the favorite job that they've ever had. And if it's not, they're going to find a new job.
What's the percentage to the team?
And you know what? Most companies in the earlier stages have a 20% pool that go to the team. I'm probably closer to 35% by the time you're done. But that'll impact, to a degree, the way I look at valuation. And again, not really from a greed standpoint, but more from a standpoint of where do I want to be at this particular point in time. But there are so many variables that go into it that I think, you know, to me, over and over and over again, the quality of the investor, particularly in the earlier stages, far more important than the quantity of the valuation.
Great. Thank you. I had a question over here.
Yeah, I'm just going to ask you to comment on two things. One is, would you give us and share your opinion about the fact that there's so much emphasis right now on the high tech, the app, and perhaps not enough on the real challenges of aging, having to do with activities of daily living, and the burden that places on caregivers, and the whole issue of patient handling.
Yeah.
And the fact that perhaps an app doesn't get to that, and we need to get the DME folks be a little bit more creative about how they think about their product. So if you would comment on that. And then I'm going to take advantage of the fact that I have a microphone and ask you to comment on the second, which is right now the acute care industry dominates healthcare. And when there's investment to be done, it's the cellular and the genomic. And if you follow at all that industry, there's tremendous amounts of investment going on there. I think long-term care pales in comparison, and how do we get respect?
Well, I think I'm going to forget both parts of the question.
I can repeat.
That's like aging 2.0 for me. The first part on the technology, I couldn't agree more. The apps are noise. There are more apps out there than there are stars in the sky, and it's actually slowing things down. And I think there's great excitement about it, just because healthcare is just, so let me give you a good example. The internet media marketplace in 95, 96, 97 underwent for me a substantial shift. And you had first the technology providers, and then you had people with content sites, and you had a whole lot of noise in that dot-com 1.0 era that needed to play through. The technology has gotten much simpler to create. So everybody and their brother can start a business. And I think you need to work through what I will call the noise of that. And I'm not saying that pejoratively. I think there are some great tools out there. But I think you need to work through the noise of it before people then start focusing on the daily living. And people have to get past the sex of the widget to the substance of what's going on in that marketplace. I don't think it's there yet. I don't think it's there yet. It's still frothy from a technology widget standpoint. And I would say that people aren't really sure when that's going to come to roost. But again, I've seen that app that is, you know, 4 a.m, let my doctor know where I'm running. And that certainly is not as important from a societal standpoint or a big enough opportunity as daily living. I'll say one other thing about it. It is easier for the investment community to get their arms around a technology because traditionally that has equaled scale. And until they realize that there's no algorithm for healthcare, and as a result you need human beings involved in some way, shape, or form, that's still going to be the focus of it, but it's going to come back. And then in terms of the second question, what was the second question?
Acute versus acute care, or gets all the money versus the rest, like preventative care, for example. Do you know what I mean?
Well, if we're going to talk preventative care, then I'd say disease management's getting a lot of money and they're probably not worth getting all that much money. From an acute care standpoint to more the chronic or the daily living, I think that to a degree for me, that sort of the Affordable Care Act direction opens up that opportunity, because if we head towards a quality of care paradigm and we head to full capitation and other types of environments, then you're stuck looking at what happens between the acute events. So you can lessen the variability and the incidences of the event. So for that, you're probably talking about 2014, 2015, before people really get their acts together.
Great, thanks. Time for one more, I think.
Yeah. So I appreciate your candor. I found point number 10 particularly interesting. I'm curious, do you think that also applies to your customers and users?
No. That's just what my wife would say about me. No, I don't think so. I am speaking straight from the entrepreneurial passion. When you walk into that room and you have 15 naysayers who are all from traditional backgrounds because it's just not how it's been done before, and that has no, conventional thinking is death. And anybody who's not challenging the conventional thinking is not moving their business forward. And so there, what I really mean is when you're in a room and 19 people are saying no, look, if it's 1 + 1 and you say the answer is 3, I get it. But I have heard more ideas come out of traditional folks that have been nailed and knocked down at that traditional environment that have gone on to build huge companies. But no, in no way, shape, or form am I talking about the customer base or whatnot. They know exactly what they need, and we need to give it to them.
All right, fantastic. Alan, thank you very much indeed.
Thank you. Steve.
10 minutes to recharge your glasses and chat with all those people that you thought were interesting, and then we'll start back again just before 8.